Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Shashwati Shah, Assistant Professor, Department of English, Sikkim University. Today we will talk about reading new literature in English. And the name of the module is English Literature in the Third World. The content of the module has been written by me. In this module, we'll try to understand the term Third World. We'll try to understand which part of the world map is called the third world and why. Then we will move on to understand the term third world literature. And we'll question whether all literature that has been written in the third world qualify as the third world literature. Having understood that, we will next question the term third world literature in English. We will look at the various debates that have cropped up from time to time about this concept of third world literature in English, and finally we'll wrap the module up with Ejaz Ahmed's idea of the third world. Let us begin. The term third world was coined by a French demographer, anthropologist and historian, Alfred Sauvé, in 1952. He used the term to denote those nations during the Cold War who were neither aligned with the communist Soviet bloc or the capitalist NATO bloc. The history of the third world countries are marked by anti-colonialism, war of liberation from the foreign rule, and mass movement. It comprises of almost all the African, Asian, and Latin American nations of the world. Third world literature is not the name for a well-defined literary corpus. The way we say South African literature or even Latin American literature, third world literature cannot be said in the same manner. This is not just because, as Ejaz Ahmed has noted, it is in the metropolitan country that a literary text is first designated as a third world text. It is also because third world literature names a historical aspiration to objectivity rather than an object per se. One might define third world literature as comprising the literatures of Asia, Africa, and Latin America, perhaps together with the respective metropolitan diasporas. But this could only work if the category was effectively restricted to works written after the end of the Second World War. And that still leaves the question of whether third world literature continues to be written, or does it capture the ideology, sentiment, and energies of nations struggling for liberation? Narasimha feels that to lump together black and brown novelists from India, Africa, and the islands in between under the caption Third World Literature is a political solution to a very delicate aesthetic problem. Frederick Jameson is of the opinion that it would be presumptuous to offer some general theory of what is often called the third world literature. Given the enormous variety both of national cultures in the third world and of specific historical trajectories in each of these areas. But some scholars are of the opinion that there are a few common denominators, like colonial past, rejection of the West, including its canonized literary model, and emphasis on canonical revision subverting the present canon. So the scenario is such that the literature that is evolving or emanating out of the third world is often questioned whether all the literature written from across the world, because third world comprises the entire of Africa, Latin America, Asia itself is huge, you know, West Asia, South Asia, Southeast Asia, whether all this literature can be categorized under one term, that is third world literature. Because all of these places have their own sort of lived experiences. They have their own way of dealing with the problems that arise in their own country. So how can all these experiences be categorized under this broad banner? This has been questioned from time to time. But some writers, some critics say that it is necessary for, you know, clubbing together these places because it's a very delicate aesthetic problem. They also say that there are many common problems that all these places had encountered. Firstly, the colonialism. Secondly, that they had been that Western culture, literature had been imposed upon them for a long time, and there is a rejection of that. And also, there is a canonical revision that is going on in this part of the world. Therefore, they can be brought under this broad banner of third world literature. Peter Nazareth gives us the definition that to belong to the third world is to accept an identity with the wretched of the earth, spoken for by Franz Fanon, to determine to end all exploitation and oppression. Third world literature, simply put, is a literature which is not of the world of the white man. Third world literature came to have inherited the revolutionary and utopian aspiration once claimed by a class. It is an anti-bourgeois literature of the world for which literature itself has seemed to become irredeemably bourgeois. The third world literature is always in dialogue with the Western world. It is through the third world literature that the first world is being called upon to assume a certain responsibility. A responsibility not for others, for the other, the third world, the oriental, or however it chooses to designate the unfamiliar, but for the limitations of its own perspective. The issue is that of identifying with the wretched of the earth and to learn from them how to look into what is really going on in the world and why it has been going on, thus to learn about our own limitation. Scholars are of the opinion that only when the literature from the third world addresses these issues that they can be regarded as the third world literature. Not all literature produced in this vast geographic area is third world literature. Some of them associate with the established literary canon of the West and become only literature. The works of those authors who fail to identify with the wretched of the earth cannot be regarded as the third world literature. That the Western canons came to influence the literary creativity, literary production of the people of the third world is not very uncommon. It's because of the fact that English was imposed on almost all the colonial or colonized nations of the world, and it is through that language that they came to know about the literature of the world other than their own country. So when these men who were educated in a educational system which does not belong to their country started writing literature, they were heavily influenced by the Western canons, the literary traditions of the West. Now, the third world literature tries to avoid this. They comprise of those writers who reject these Western canons. The ones they come up with their own canons, they write about their own lives, their everyday lived experiences in their own language, in their own way. Franz Fanon delineated three stages of the development of third world literature culture. Number one, pre-independence literature. Native intellectuals show that they have assimilated the culture of the occupying power. We might cite here negritude literature and the early pre-independence novel in Africa. Number two, literature of just before the battle. The natives are restless. This literature is dominated by humor and allegory. Often, according to Fanon, this kind of literature is symptomatic of a period of distress and difficulty, where death is experienced and disgust too. We spool ourselves up, but underneath laughter can be heard. Number three, fighting literature, revolutionary literature. Fanon extensively cites the Guinean Keita Fodiba's African Dawn, pointing out that the understanding of the poem is not merely an intellectual advance, but a political advance. George M. Gugelberger talks of another three stages. According to him, number one stage is literature responding to colonialism, inciting the fight against oppression while using the literary tool of the oppressor. This is the colonial phase. Number two, encomiastic literature, a short phrase celebrating nationalism and independence. Number 3, literature which sees independence for what it is, that is flag independence, and assesses the new development of neocolonialism, class consciousness. Thus, third world literature is implicitly seen as a fighting literature, an opposing literature, a literature which deals with the nation building, a literature which deals with oppression, a literature which negates oppression. Now, what is third world English? Is third world English similar to the English that is spoken in the Western world? Or is it a different sort of English? Is it an English that came out of the experiences that they have in their own country? It's an English that came out after they had learned the British English and then modified it to suit their own needs and necessities. Albeit, most of the third world comprise of nations once under British colonialism, there is no denying that there has been a change in the attitude of the speakers of Mother English, that is British English, towards the third world Englishes. Perhaps because of the political emancipation of many English using third world countries, admittedly, there has also been a perceptible change in the attitude of the third world users of English in recent years. So therefore, the third world English is not a singular term. We use Englishes because it tries to encompass the sensibilities, the experiences of a number of people who have their own English depending on the country to which they belong to. Now, third world literature in English. There's a huge debate about whether third world can at all adequately express themselves in English, which is but an alien language. It is said that creative expression might not be possible when you are using a language which is not your own. It is a case of what Meenakshi Mukherjee will call double complication, because it is written in a language that in most cases is not the first language of the writer, nor is it the language of the daily life of the people about whom the novels are written. Apart from dialogue, even in description, narration and reflection, the third world writers in English are dealing with modes of thinking, manners of observation and instinctive responses of people whose awareness has been conditioned in a language other than English. Yet, writers like Wole Soyinka, Chinua Achebe, Nadine Gordimer are valued for their politically engaged and racially outspoken writings because they can transform their local experience into universal art. We also come across such writers who use English for linguistic experimentation. English language and literature has become a sphere of exchange in which writers of all stripes can participate and they can exchange ideas about their position, be it political, economic or social. So, as you can see, the writers writing in English from the third world are faced with two challenges. First of all, they are themselves not English-speaking people. So therefore, their way of thinking, their way of cognizing their immediate surrounding will be in a language that is not English. Moreover, the characters that they are depicting, the kind of emotions that they are depicting in their literature will also be in a language that is of their own. But they are choosing an alien language, a language in which they have to bring out all those emotions that a literature demands. Many critics have questioned this category called the third world literature in English. In fact, there have been serious reservations expressed about the advisability of a creative writing in an alien language. It has been said that creative self-expression may not be possible when you are using a language which is not your own. Indian English writers are accused of not being authentically Indian or are accused of being anxious to prove their Indianness. According to M.K. Nayak, Indian poetry in English is only occasionally poetry and sometimes Indian, because unless an art is rooted in the soil, it is bound to be condemned to both superficiality and artificiality. According to Buddhadev Bose, there could be no Indian poetry in English after independence, and that only pre-independence poets could be called Indian English poets, because their ambition was to become English poets in every sense of the word. Bose argues the pre-independence poets ought to be taken more seriously than the later poets, who insist they are Indians writing in English, a language with which Bose cannot see why they should write at all. This also reminds us of Ngugi wa Thiong'o's contribution to the language debate that arose among the African writers. Ngugi focuses on questions about the African writer's linguistic medium. Should one write in one's indigenous language or a hegemonic language like French or English? Thus, the question of whether or not to write in African languages is a serious one for the African writer. As Oliver Lovesey, a scholar of Thiong'o, notes in his book on him that this is a dilemma of the African writers today. Either he may use a European language and thus gain recognition and financial reward from a worldwide audience, but at the risk of cutting himself off from the very roots of all, but the most esoteric creative flowering, the common experience of his own society. Or he may use his own mother tongue, stoically shun the appeal of the world market, remain one of the inglorious millions of the present age, but help his own people's advance into the age of mass literacy and pave the way for future achievements and renown. For Ngugi, language also carries the histories, values, and aesthetics of a culture along with it. As he puts it, language as culture is a collective memory bank of a people's experience in history. Culture is almost indistinguishable from the language that makes possible its genesis, growth, banking, articulation, and indeed its transmission from one generation to the next. So you can understand, language is embedded in culture. Language cannot be differentiated from culture. This is the reason why in every language there's something called culture specific items, which are of that culture and they have no equivalent English words. Now the question is, when you are depicting a particular culture in a language that does not belong to a culture, how do you depict those very culture specific items, those emotions that are very particular to that culture? This is the thing that Thiong'o is talking about, and he questions it. He passionately advocates for the overall development of African language and their use in African, and he famously renounced writing in English. Apart from dialogue, even in description, narration, and reflection, the third world writers are dealing with modes of thinking, manners of observation, and instinctive responses of people whose awareness has been conditioned by a language other than English. Thus, third world writers are faced with an almost impossible task of shaping and renewing a language which they cannot call their own with complete assurance and acceptance, which means they have to use English language in such a way, they have to shape it up in such a way that it can encapsulate their own experiences. Therefore, the English that they are using do not remain the English of the British population or the English speaking population. This English is very different from the mother English. Now, let us come to the counter arguments, which means the arguments that were put forward in favor of writing in English from the third world. P. Lal remarked at a seminar on Indian writing in English that the debate about whether Indians can write in English is over. He sent a questionnaire to 75 Indian poets to find out why they wrote in English, and most of them said that they found it quite natural to express themselves in this language. According to Sashi Deshpande, and I'm quoting, Those of us who write in English, it is neither a foreign language nor the language of the colonizer, but the language of our creativity. Whether the writing is rootless, alienated or elitist should be judged from the writing, not from the language. In fact, Mahatma Gandhi once told Mulk Raj Anand, "The purpose of writing is to communicate, isn't it? If so, say what you want to say in any language that comes to hand." So basically, this group of writers and scholars is emphasizing on expressing your emotions, expressing your ideas, whichever language it might be. It is not necessary that you always use your own mother tongue in describing your emotions. It can very well be described in another language if you are proficient in it. Chinua Achebe argues that it is neither necessary nor desirable for the African writer to write English like a native speaker. He feels that the English language will be able to carry the weight of my African experience, but it will have to be a new English, still in full communion with its ancestral home, but altered to suit the new African surroundings. Raja Rao is of the opinion that one has to convey in a language that is not one's own the spirit that is one's own. He wants the author's writing in English to develop our own style, which may adequately describe our experience and emotions. Ejaz Ahmed complains that the Western Academy has codified the Third World into a unitary archive that includes only the writers whom the hegemonic literary critics of the metropolitan thinks suitable. This archive, with the stamp of Western sanction attached to it, is then redistributed to the Third World as a monolithic Third World literature. Ahmed takes up the case of English in India and examines the impact it had on class formation. He points out that although this literature allows a conversation between writers from different constituencies of the Third World, it is consumed in English or in other languages of the metropole. He also questioned whether the literature produced by the immigrant population from the Third World who are now living in the metropole can be called Third World literature. So, Ahmed is making a difference in the writings of the Third World writers, ones who are living in their own country and writing in English, and the ones who are residing in the metropoles, that is the diasporic writers who are also writing in English. He's saying, albeit both of them are from the Third World, do you think there's a similarity between their work? He thinks there's a stark difference, because the ones who are living in their own country are experiencing the struggles, the problems in their everyday life on a day-to-day basis. But these people have a privileged position because they have moved away from this life of struggle, life of problems and other issues. Here in this privileged position, they are moving further and further from the lived reality of the Third World. Therefore, the literature they produce will be very different from the literature produced from the Third World. He says the immigrant population experiences privileged class position as a result of their location in the metropolitan academy. As a result of this, a difference develops between the writings that are produced in the actual geophysical spaces of the Third World and the writings of the immigrants in the metropole. Thus, we can see that English literature in the Third World is a fairly contested domain. Although there's a large output of English literature written in the Third World, they have to really prove that they actually belong to the Third World, that they represent the Third World adequately. Therefore, only those literature written in English that gives us national allegory can be called the Third World literature, encompassing all the lived experiences of the everyday life of the people of the Third World. I hope you have enjoyed the module and it will encourage you to learn more about Third World literature written in English. Thank you very much.